story again before the media was not here that time.
Okay, our pharmacy faculty has been here for several years, but we're using prefabricated buildings. So that this time we had to knock down the prefabricated buildings to pick up a building that will befit our Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences. It's been sponsored by the Education Trust Fund for about 460 million naira. So that's the work that we can see going on here.
When did this start? When will it be handed over?
It started last year, 2012, and we hope that in 52 weeks the project will be completed.
2 weeks is less than a year.
Yes.
What's the capacity?
DPP, what's the capacity?
We have a lecture auditorium. We also have laboratories, classrooms, and offices for the lecturers. Actually, this is phase one of the project. The phase two is also a replica of this with a freestanding admin block, which will come as soon as the funds have.
Vice Chancellor, I'm the acting for the Vice Chancellor, but I'm the Deputy Vice Chancellor Academic, Professor IU Asuzu. Deputy Vice Chancellor Academic, acting for the Vice Chancellor. The Vice Chancellor is unavoidably absent. Thank you. This university had to renovate this hall and 18 others, 19 hostels. The windows were changed from louvers to Almaco sliding windows, and all the roofs were changed to long span. The toilet ends were refurbished, you know, and just to make the place comfortable for our students. So this was done with our IGR, internally generated revenue. Thank you very much. It's the same thing in Enugu campus. How many hostels? 11 hostels in Enugu campus also were renovated. Thank you. The activity center that is built by this administration, it has reached an advanced stage. In fact, very soon it will be put to use. I hope that by the time we just finish this briefing, we'll just go in there for 1 minute and come at least appreciate the kind of work that is going on there. Here we house the Students Union and also Recreation Center, Student Affairs Office. You know, all of them will be housed in this complex. And we're also doing it with our IGR. Yes, IGL. Yes, am I correct? IGL, yes. IGL.
What's the cost?
About 150.
What's the total cost for completing the project?
You see this project? We, you know, we did that from our IGR, and this other one, and this other road too, was completed last week with our IGR. Yes. What? Meters.
Cost.
Cost 97 million and then 36.7 million, you know, because of the
direct level.
Yes. Yes. So I was just saying that in this dispensation, we have realized that no institution can do well without collaborating with others, particularly those in the first world. And this university has entered into a number of MOUs with universities in America and Europe and the East. And they intend to the staff of those universities want to visit us and then see what we have here and then contribute to knowledge. And when they come, they need a place where they'll be comfortable. So this place, which we call the International Scholars Village, is to house them when they are here, whether for 3 months or for 1 year, as the case may be. And here we provide all the facilities that will make them comfortable during their short stay here. So democracy is actually working. And you can see that globalization and all that, you know, is taking place at this time. And I want to let you know that we are benefiting from the democratic.
What about in terms of the infrastructure development in university in recent times?
The truth is that everyone who has come here in the recent time has been surprised with the rate of development, infrastructure wise. Where a number of buildings have cropped up, you know, structures. The old ones have been expanded, you know, to take more room for our students. The classrooms are all being digitized. You know, we have smart boards now instead of electronic boards, instead of blackboards. And these electronic boards will enable our lecturers to present their lectures, you know, using a PowerPoint presentation. And the lectures are recorded. The lecturer can download things from the internet as he's teaching, you know, to make teaching more interesting, and the students will understand. And if a student misses any lecture, because the lectures are being recorded, we have a database where the student can access and get that lecture he missed. So all these things are to make education what it's supposed to be.
Because one of the 12 universities for the electronic learning platforms that we approved at the Federal Executive Council.
Nsukka was it?
Yes,
Nsukka was one of them.
Yes. The impact is beginning to make.
That's right. Like I said, we have an ICT, very bogus ICT infrastructure here. This university now has 155 Mbps of bandwidth. And actually, we're trying to also extend the fiber optics to the different departments and different offices. So, with access to internet, even here. And this has made teaching and learning more interesting and more fruitful.
One last question.
Huh? 83 bedrooms.
Yes.
Self-contained. Yeah. Okay.
Sorry. Chudi Nwafor is my name. Sir, from AIT, Africa Independent Television and RayPower FM. The standard of education in Nigeria, does it worry you? And then we are talking about infrastructure development. What do you consider the biggest challenge that the education sector is, you know, faces in Nigeria today? And what's the way out? I'm happy the Honorable Minister for Information is here. The Enugu State Acting Governor is here also. Thank you so much, sir.
Ask all the questions.
Thank you very much. My name is Eke Chigwanslem from National Planning Commission. Sir, I was here 2008. I think that was when the school hosted the Nuga Games. And a lot of structures were abandoned. Then, as we drove around as we were coming in, I saw that all those structures what is the VC doing? The stadium, the badminton court, the hockey pitch, those structures, and many more. I saw them as I was coming in since 2008. What is the school doing about it?
Did you see some other structures that have been worked on since
2008? Okay, I can talk about those ones. Really, yeah, no, I saw some structures. I saw the pharmacy department, the economics department, they are all coming up. But I'm talking of, we are working against, we don't want to see abandoned projects anywhere we go to. So that's why we're emphasizing on these things. So 2008, when we hosted Nuga Games, they are still the way they were. I want to know why they are still in that state.
Thank you very much. My name is Molara Wood. Sorry to be taking us away from this particular project. I'd like to inject literature into this. An old student of UNN, Chika Unigwe, won the NLNG Prize for Literature, 100,000 Naira Prize, and she's going to be presented with the award in this $100,000 prize, and she's going to be awarded tomorrow. And I know that some of the best art journalists in this country are here now. She's also on this campus right now. I'd just like to know what the school, the university administration feels about this, and how you intend to capitalize on her achievement to actually inspire your students. Thank you very much.
Well, you asked whether I'm disturbed about the standard of education in this country.
Of course I am. And I'm somebody who has traveled all over the world. I've been to very good laboratories out there. So each time I come back here, I get disturbed. So the biggest problem we have here is funding. You see, you cannot do any of these things without funding. You cannot buy an equipment without funding. You see, so one of our biggest problems is funding. You can see that in this university, we're working so hard to make sure that our students get what they need. We're doing our best, but we think we should also be encouraged.
Is what has been brought on board from primary and secondary to secondary school level. So we are working with state government because that is completely outside federal control. You can't determine how a state is running its primary schools. You can't determine how a state is running its secondary schools. But we can set standards, we have policies, you know. But now we are also funding primary education. If you look at what universal basic education is done, look at the monies that are going to states every year. They run into hundreds of billions of naira on a yearly basis. And look at the third fund. Look at the most projects in the university today are third fund driven, even more than the line capital budgets. So that is what is going on. So I think that if what we are doing goes on uninterrupted over a period of time, the universities will return to their normal or former glory. They will return. And even at this level, you know, I can tell you that, I mean, my children finished university recently, and I try to compare, you know, what they have done to what was my own situation. And when I discuss with them, I find that the outlandish condemnation of standards does not tell the truth. Because I see that they are functioning very well. They debate with me, and I know that their discussion is of a standard that I'm comfortable with. I believe those children can compete with those coming from abroad than the universities here. So it's not everything that is done. You can't say that the standard in Nsukka. So, no. Because the old lecturers, many of them are still here. A tradition has been established, and people are moving on. We are changing the learning system now with ICT. So children can now from here also access libraries in Oxford or Harvard, anywhere in the world. They can compete and see things. So things are coming. The problem we have is we don't seem to understand that this is where we are coming from. And this is the journey we are making. So I believe that the universities will come back. We are presently also working on a grant scheme to fund the entire system. Because after we received the report of the joint ASU-NUC presentation to the Federal Executive Council, we stated the infrastructure gap deficit in virtually all state and federal universities. We are working at the National Economic Council to see how we can come up with a policy to generate more funding, private sector intervention, government intervention, to generate additional funding for the universities. So reforms will take place, and it's not easy. So at the same time we are doing this, we are also confronting other problems in the country. Look at what we have spent on security. If Nigerians gave this government a chance and didn't unleash the violence we have seen in the northern part of the country, if you look at the money we have spent on security, if we deploy it in education, I mean, we could have definitely closed all the gaps that we have now. So as a country, I think particularly for the media, there is a need for us. And that's why we're undertaking this tour, to give more attention to redevelopment processes that are taking place in the various theaters. But there is too much politicization. We make political statements rather than factual statements. And that is not very, very well. Let me commend Nsukka. As I was here in 1988. I haven't been here since that time. And I know that this is a different place than what we saw. Zig flats were virtually collapsing at that time. If you look at the roof and everything, you see painting that has not been changed for 10, 15 years. But we are seeing almost every building on this campus has been touched. Hostels, faculty buildings, and new structures. Almost all of them are looking different. Roofs changed, windows changed, painting and everything going on. And that is the kind of thing that I thought we should appreciate. But when you just look at one thing that didn't work, you now use it to condemn the progress that you see, which is not what So, but the reality is that a lot of changes are taking place. We can change more. We can move faster. But we have generated a lot of problems for the country. And so resources are being diverted, you know, needlessly into areas that we would have used for national development. So our democracy must focus on attitudinal change. We don't have that attitudinal change. We don't have it. I've always advocated that maybe we can't educate our children from outside. We must educate them in this country. We must educate them in this country. You know, and most of the people running out of the country are not necessarily because our universities are so bad that their children cannot school here. You know it. People just think that if your child didn't school in Europe, then you are not important. I didn't school in Europe. And I'm confident that I can debate anybody, whether you came from Oxford or Harvard or anywhere. Let's concentrate and make this country work. But let us also encourage the processes of change that are coming on slowly, but steadily, you know, for progress. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, Honorable Minister. Also, to be fair to the private sector, we're also, because we know that this load is too much for the federal government, we've been going out to the private sector, and then we have a number of collaborations with the private sector, you know, the banks like Fidelity Bank, First Bank, and Diamond Bank, and also good-spirited individuals, you know, businessmen who have made good contributions towards the projects that we have, that have been carried out in this university. So I need to acknowledge them also. They've made some useful contributions.